Oh, yeah. Wait, this one. The Lex Fridman one on dominance and submission.
Dominance and submissiveness.
Do we like Lex? I go back and forth on him. Sometimes I really like him and I think he's really introspective. And then sometimes I hear him and I'm like, Lex, no. Like, he just seems, I'm always, I like people who think, but I always find them so, like, their emotions are in the weirdest place for me. Like, I don't like where Lex's emotions feel, but I kind of like the way his brain works, because it's kind of like, smart, stupid. Like me. There's something, I like smart, stupid. We're like, you know they're kind of stupid, but you know they're kind of smart. That's what Lex reminds me of.
This.
He's a fake. There's something about him that feels very dumb to me and something about him that feels very smart. And I think it's the same way people feel about me where it's like, I like her, but she bothers me.
Something you've also written about. What's the role of that inside relationships about this human dynamic of dominance and submissiveness?
But I feel like I'd have to be the top in the relationship with him. And I can't long-term date a bottom boy. Sorry, Lex. We're not going to be a couple. I need a guy who's a switch or a top. But a girl who's a bottom. I don't want to date a top girl. I want to date a bottom girl or a switch. It's because... Ooh, why is that? Yeah, that's my preference. So my ideal preference is have a switch guy or a top guy. A bottom girl or a switch girl. But I don't want to date a girl who's a top. Only a top. And I don't want to date a guy who's only a bottom. I think that's because I'm a switch with, why is that the case? Somebody dissect me.
Is that a feature or a bug? So the stable state that these dynamical systems are.
Gimple, is Lex asexual?
By that. Is it good to have an equality within a relationship? Or is it good to have differences in a relationship?
Are you talking about romantic relationships or just in human relationships?
Romantic, probably, because unless it could be generalized to human relationships, perhaps it could be generalized to human relationships. I wasn't thinking that, but perhaps it could be. But let's start with romantic. I guess one-on-one.
I'm personally in favor of equality on that dimension within romantic relationships. And I don't talk about my personal life, but I've been in relationships, and the best ones tend to be those where there's equality, and one person does not dominate the other.
So switchy.
But I guess the reason I ask you is in what type of relationships, because there's some things like coalitions where hierarchy is very important to the function of the coalition. So it's like if you're like a war coalition or something in small group warfare, you can't just have equality. You have to have leaders that are determining the battle plan, so to speak. And so if you have you're attacking a neighboring group or something, and everyone gets an equal say, it's not going to work that way. And so we tend to appoint as leaders those who are doesn't always work out well, but those who are...
Japanese businessman says, you want the best of both worlds. A bottom boy maybe feels like a worse version of a bottom woman, and a top girl maybe feels like a worse version of a top man. That is so what it is. I like top women, but I like top men more, and I like bottom girls more than I like bottom boys. I'm so heteronormative, right? Am I the heteronormative person? I think I'm heteronormative. Even in my gayness, I'm heteronormative because I want the top role because I make the money. Madison says, Brittany, what's your experience with bottom boys and top girls? No long-term partners except my first girlfriend. We dated for about a year. I wouldn't call that really long-term. I think 2 years or more is kind of long-term to me. But she was a top to me exclusively. And that was fun. That was great. And then I've had plenty of female top partners, like casual sex partners, and a lot of casual bottoms or switch boys. And I'm attracted to everybody, but not long term. So I'm attracted to all types of people for sex and BDSM totally, But long-term dating, either a guy has to be a top or a switch, and a girl either has to be a switch or a bottom. I just, like, can't long-term bottom to a woman, and I can't long-term top a guy. It's just not going to happen. I'm going to need it fed into me. But if a guy is just a top, I could handle that. Because top... Yeah, for some reason I've been able to... Yeah, I can handle that for some reason. I wonder why. But yeah, I feel... You know, I probably just want to ultimately be taken care of. Maybe because I'm more of a bottom than a top. But then a top girl makes... No, because I want a bottom girl. So maybe it's sexism. Yeah, I'd feel fine topping a girl. But then I like being in control. Oh, it's sexism. Maybe it is sexism. Hold on. Because maybe I feel like... Why would I miss... I would miss it. I would miss a masculine top energy, but I wouldn't miss a top energy from a woman. Why would I miss it from a man? Do I think men are better tops and women are better bottoms? Guys, this is like... I think it's sexism, which I think is fine. Yeah, I think that's within my values of my consistency, though. I'm pretty into traditional mating relationships. Like, I'm pretty into the traditional role. Like, I do want to stay home with my kids and work from home. I'm just a modern, traditional woman because I do want to stay home. I don't want to leave my house to work, and I'm never going to be, and I don't care if my husband works a lot. But I wouldn't want a woman to work more than me. I'd be more competitive with her. Why? I just think I'd be better at it. Yeah, I think that's it. Maybe I wouldn't trust her as much as I just trust a man. Why don't I like it? Because if I dated, like, any of the girl from the L Word, I wouldn't trust them to continue making money. But I would trust me to make money. And I would trust a man to make money. Oh, okay. Here's why. Men are more apt to make money because they actually do like things better than people. But I don't trust a woman other than me not to get lost in her feelings over money. Because Sneeko's right. There is a part of me that does think more like in my masculine. And I think feminine. Oh, maybe I'm imagining feminine. Oh, so I'm imagining... Okay, I could bottom to a... Nope, I could not. Also, my family wouldn't... I think my family would accept me being a top more than they would accept me being a bottom. To a girl. Wait, okay, so this stems back from my family. I know I couldn't... I know I could... I know my siblings would accept me being in a switchy relationship or in a relationship with a bottom girl. But they wouldn't understand why a butch woman, like a top, like a openly masked woman... would be here, and I probably wouldn't bottom to a femme woman. And even so, they wouldn't respect it because I'm more dominant than anyone they've ever met. And if I married a man, I would only marry a top man because I've never met a man who could dominate me. And or a woman. Oh, that's what it is. Yeah. Maybe I feel like, what? It's something to do with that. It's something like that. Okay. Now I will read your comments criticizing my introspection. Okay. Let's see. What is a switch? I've been called this. So, like, you know those people you meet and no matter what, they're, like, never bottoming to people? Like, they're always, like, in charge. They're always tops in the situation. Those are tops. And, like, people who are, like, moved to bottom. Like, what should we do? Like, usually, you know what I mean? You can just tell in a good way or bad way. Like, when Farm Brother and I are together, there's even dynamics in family situations. Like, if my parents are both switches. So, like, in the right situations, like, my mom, you know what I mean? My parents switch. But, like, in our house, it's, like, different. Like, my little brother is not going to dominate me, bro. Like, I'm obviously the top. And not just because I'm his older sister. Because I'm fucking... My switchy energy keeps me in my masculine. So, and I think masculine and feminine are fine words. There's nothing... Men can be feminine, women can be masculine. They serve totally different purposes. Think people over things. Think things over people. You know what I mean? Like, I will always choose making money if it's my survival than, like, my emotions. Like, I don't care how much I like you. If you get in the way of me making my bag, I'm going to get really upset. And I'm going to kick you out of my life. Friends or lovers. But I know girls who would give up their whole career for a man or a friend, or, and I won't. But I don't care about money enough that I would fight my partner. If he was like, I really want to work and I want you to work part-time, I'd be like, go, bitch. I don't like work that much. Damn. You know what I'm saying? That's me automatically taking the bottom role of like, I don't even like work that much. I like what I do here, which is not the same as leaving the house and going to an office, which sounds awful. I don't fucking want to do that. I'm like tough. I'm a top, but I'm a bottom when it comes to being lazy. I'm literally tough. What is tough? A switch. With aggressive top energy. But would love to be a bottom because she doesn't want to do shit. I don't want to build a fence. I want to pay my brothers to build the fence for me. Do you guys get what I'm saying? But I'm the one paying.
We're presumably wise or good, effective leaders. And they even talk about, and I'm sure you're familiar with this, and I'm not an expert on this, but...
TMM says, I prefer top women, so I guess I'm less heteronormative despite being heterosexual. That makes sense. I'm down for whatever. Hint, sexy people sliding to my DMs. Thirsty audience. Japanese businessman says, you're explaining it to a monkey. Love it. I'm a top, middle, side, diagonal. Oh, gimbal. Let's see. Ch-ch-ch-ch. Just because I love top men who switch in gentle doms with me, but it can be rough. But it can be tough. Men love that I'm dom, especially dom men. So no one loves a top more than a bottom, which tops always attract. Oh, God. I'm too high to read your sentence, girl. I'm too high. Oh, my gosh. TMM says, I've always been uncomfortable dating bottom women because I don't like the pressure of having to make the most of the decisions. That's what it is. I love making decisions. I do. But if I had a top enough of a man, I'd be like, babe, make the decisions. I fucking want to watch anime and hang out with the kids. But I'm great at making decisions. So I'm like a great backup. I just don't want to do it all the time. But like, I will if I have to because I'm great at it. You know what I'm saying? You know when you're great at something, but you still don't want to do it? That's me. I'm great at making decisions. I still don't want to do it. So I do it if I'm single. But if I date a woman, I feel like I'm going to make better decisions than her. Oh, I'm sexist. I'm sorry. Okay? I'm sorry. It's just women, they get lost in their feelings. And I cry all the time on this stream. Oh, I'm turning into the red pill. Sneeko was right. I'm so sorry. But look at that conversation we just had today. Where, like, I read these articles about these women who just marry these men and that they don't want to work or do anything. And I'm like, what are you doing? You have to make decisions. Like, you can't be passive in your own life. I mean, you can. It's just unattractive. So even if I had a bottom girlfriend, she better be motivated and passionate. Like, she better have passion. Why is it different? Guys, this weed is really fucking with me.
You know, wartime leaders versus peacetime leaders. And so, again, it depends on, you know, what the goal is of the group that you are a part of. And so I think there is functionality and utility to a lot of our evolved psychology of status and dominance and submissiveness.
Conrad says Toph is a top, so she ended up alone. Yeah, but she got two kids out of it and then ended up in her awesome swamp, bro. She has the best life, bro. Toph ended up with the perfect life. She shouldn't have been a cop, though. That was lame. But she ended up in the perfect... She ended up in the swamp. That's the best. I am gonna die alone. Oh, can't wait. I talked to my buddy about this. She's like an older lady. Her husband died. She's really independent, though. And she's very rich. And she just like... And she made the money. Her husband didn't. He was a stay-at-home husband. Kind of. He worked part-time eventually, and then he didn't, and she paid for their life. But either way, he was great. But there's always something weird about it, but he was helpful around the house, and so that was good. But they didn't have kids, and she's really cool. But anyways, she's helping me learn how to buy a house, and she's very, like, work savvy. But her life's pretty cool, dude. She has, like, horses and a ranch, and, like, she's awesome. Her life's pretty good. She has, like, a beautiful house, and she paints, and she has cats. I don't know. Like, her husband passing was a bummer for sure. But they always were, like, kind of roommates, like, friends. If that makes sense, they were one of those couples, you know what I mean? It's like she's always been independent her whole life. Anyways, what I'm trying to say is, I don't think it's a bad thing to end up, like, I will refuse to believe that being single is, like, the worst. But then Kyoti and I talked about this today, is that I'm not really, like, even if you're single, if you have a big family, you're never alone. So, like, I don't feel like I'm single because I don't crave relationships like that, like, romantic ones, because I have, like, family all around me. So I'm like, oh, I'm good. I'm not alone. I don't think, you know what I'm saying? This is very good conversation. Love it so much.
So, for example, and you have to look at the individual psychology, and this is actually something I'm currently studying, again, with Patrick Durkee.
Ooh, Japanese businessman, you're on it today. You're single, not solo. Exactly. Like, I'm not alone. So I just don't care as much about partnership. If anything, the reason I'm not dating is because I'm not going to find anyone cool enough in the bubble I have. I want them to be cool enough to join my bubble. Like, I want them to move to my house. I don't want to live in the city. So I'm asking someone to, like, be somebody who's together but willing to move to the country, unless they already live in the country.
Where one advantage of the status hierarchies is that you're not always battled.
Sorry, and that makes me feel like I'm automatically at the top, which makes me feel like I'm going to end up with a bottom woman. Unless a man wants to top that.
Fine. You know, so you determine, and that's why, and here's another sexually dimorphic aspect of our psychology, formidability assessment. So there's evidence that males engage in this, you know, can I take this guy or can he take me? Like, and it's like
the entirety of my life, yes.
It's like a spontaneous assessment of...
I do that when I meet people. The first thought I have is, can I take you in a fight and would I have sex with you? That's the first question I ask myself. You all think I'm thinking about the levels? No, I'm way more perverted. When I meet people, I'm not thinking about the levels. I'm literally thinking, can I take you in a fight and would I have sex with you? Yeah. I'm an animal, bro.
Of formidability. And it also, that information is critical because that means, like, who you should not challenge or who you can challenge with impunity. So, and there's functionality to submitting as well, you know, because you defer to someone so that you don't get vanquished and you live to see another day. So I think we actually have a very rich psychology of status hierarchies and dominance and submissiveness.
So especially sort of violent conflict. Yes. But back to relationships. So maybe phrased another way. What is masculinity? What is femininity? Is there value inside a relationship for differences?
Ooh.
You talked about mating strategies with the dating stage where you're selecting the mate, but also within, you know, mating broadly defined as the entirety of the process. Should those differences be magnified and celebrated or sort of suppressed?
I've seen enough different relationships work and I've seen enough relationships implode to say there's not one size fits all on these things. So even with respect to masculinity and femininity, some reduce it psychologically to two other terms, which are agency and communion. So where agency is, you know, are you instrumental, goal-oriented, get tasks done, et cetera. Communion is, you know, more the love and forming connections with other people and so forth.
See, I can do both. I can literally do both. That's what I'm saying. So I have to always fight between which one I'm doing more or the other. And then I try to stay balanced between the two. And then depending on what kind of a partner I have, I want to do more in the other one. Do you know what I'm saying? The partner I have will tell me what to do more of. But reflexively, I want to do more of the bottoming. If I'm with a man, and more of the topping if I'm with a girl.
And I published a study a while back on what's called unmitigated agency and unmitigated communion. So there are like good and bad aspects of agency and communion. So
they can go. So there's toxic, as they say, masculinity, toxic femininity. You can just rephrase that saying there could be toxic agency and toxic communion.
Yeah. And so some elements of masculinity, the unmitigated masculinity is, I think, terrible. I was actually walking around downtown Austin earlier today, and I was giving this example, and this guy was, I guess, stuck and wanted the car ahead of him to move. And all of a sudden, he screamed out of his window, "Move your fucking car!" Yeah. And then jumped out of his car and to approach the other guy. To me, that's talk.
Sorry, listen to this. There's a movie I've never seen about a couple who's like on an island or some shit. And they run into somebody that they don't know who's a stranger. They're like lost for days. I'm telling this story horribly. Just fucking follow me. It's a straight couple. And they're walking in there like in a forest or some shit. And this guy approaches them. And it looks like the guy's going to have a gun or some shit like that. And the husband or boyfriend screams and hides behind the girl. And for the rest of the movie, it's just like this lingering, uncomfortable thing. And literally, I told Farm Brother that, and he's like, "What a pussy." I was like, "What a pussy, bro." And I feel that way. I feel like you're kind of a pussy if you hide behind your partner. But I think you're kind of a pussy if you do it either way. Like, because I'm definitely the woman that's like, I would step in front of somebody. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, I wouldn't hide behind my partner if shit went down. I'm always the bracer. But I would expect certain people to fight me to be the wall. Because that's like, there's a hierarchy of who's more top. Do you get what I'm saying? There is a hierarchy. So if me, Farm Brother, and sister-in-law are together, it goes, he's the most top, I'm second top, she's third top. So like if the kids were being shot out, she would guard the kids, I would guard her reflexively, and he would guard me. But like if I went to go guard him, it would almost ruin the formation of like who's more, you know what I'm saying? I know it sounds stupid gay, but it wouldn't, there's a reason for it. It's instinctual. It's like, it's in my blood. I can feel that that's the answer. That is the answer. There's like an answer to it. That's because like, he's just like, he's stronger. He's literally physically bigger. And if I was physically bigger and stronger, then I would be in charge. It is like literally the person who is most apt to handle the situation. Do you get what I'm saying? It's not sexism. It's literally like efficiency. Japanese businessman says, "I'm curious, Brittany, you mentioned a lot of things you'd compromise on for a relationship. What are things you'd compromise on? Time. Like if my partner had like I won't move to the city. I refuse. I'm not doing it. You want a crazy fucking wife? You want a borderline triggered bitch? We'll move to the city. I'm trying to keep you safe, bitch. We have to live in the country. I don't go crazy in the country. I love the country. I fucking hate the cities. So I would compromise on time. Like I love time with my partner. I'd like to see them every day. I'd like for them to work at home. But if my partner has like a business in the city and like travels a lot for work or does like tours or something like that, I would be fine compromising on time. My ideal partner would never be not at home to some extent, or they'd have a job they go to or something, depending on what kind of a worker they are. But we'd go to sleep in the same bed every night. That's really what I want. But I would compromise on that. In some ways, like I wouldn't, like I know for some girls, they won't date a person who doesn't come home every night. I'd be open through compromise of I get to live in the country, but you get to go on tour. Then I'd be like, fine, that makes sense. And also, I don't care if you go on tour. I just like, I'm also needy. So like, I don't know if I could consciously date a guy in the military who's away for 8 months at a time, but I could handle like a comedian or like an author or YouTuber or Twitch person who was like, hey, I have to go to conferences 4 times a year. Or, hey, I have to travel for work. Like, that makes sense to me. I feel like that's reasonable. Right? Like, that's what I imagine compromising on. But no compromising on values. But, like, other than that, I'm pretty flexible. Like, where we live, as long as it's in the country, I don't care. I don't care if we buy a humble house or a rich house. I don't care if we have horses or, you know, I just don't care about, as long as our kids are taken care of and we're all good. Like, I buy cheap clothes. I don't care about diamond rings. I don't know. Is that compromising? Because that's what I think compromising is. Is like if my, I don't know, if my person wants to do something I don't want to do, go do it. I don't know.
It's like masculinity, if you will. We don't need that, you know.
Yeah. So, and by the way, as somebody who worked with cars quite a long time in terms of human interaction with semi-autonomous vehicles, it's so fascinating how the car and traffic brings out like the worst in human nature, in a sense, or maybe to rephrase that, it maybe challenges you to explore something that in terms of temper, in terms of anger, in terms of anxiety that you have been bottling it up. There's something that where the car is like a vessel for psychological.
This is going to be our last video of the night, FYI. I can feel my spoons dwindling. I can feel them. This is our last video of the night.
Experiment of how much stress you can take, and some people that stress is like heating, it's making the water boil, and it's fascinating to see what that results in. I think if you are the kind of person that explodes emotionally in traffic, that means there's deeper issues to sort of confront, and it seems like the traffic and the car is a place where you get to confront your the shadow. Mm-hmm. Carl Jung's shadow. There's something deep within that we don't often fish. We're alone with ourselves, and we get to see who we truly are.
Yeah. Well, it can bring out road rage. And also there's this, I don't know, when you're in the vehicle, you have this shell around you. And so there's this feeling that you are protected from.
Yes. So you could be yourself, you can be your true self in this moment. And sometimes that true self in this moment is an angry, screaming person, which means you have to introspect that shadow, shine a light.
Very interesting. Okay, stop.